ए माँ, ये क्या है पता है क्या? इसे कहते हैं घोड़ा। इसको ऐसे किया, ट्रिगर दबाया और खेल खलास। और ये क्या है पता है क्या? इसे कहते हैं 50 तोला सोना। कितना? 50 तोला सोना। Hey folks, CA Rachna Ranade here and I welcome you all to another interesting IPO video analysis which is about Kalyan Jewelers. But in the first part of the video, I just tried to do something which was totally outside my comfort zone. But I hope you liked a bit different shade of my acting skills, right? Let's understand a few brief points about the company. The very first thing is that they're the largest jewelry company in India based on the revenue as at 31st March 2020, according to Technopak report. What does the company do? The company designs, manufactures, and sells a wide variety of gold and studded and other jewelry products across various price points. Well, just in case, what is studded jewelry? Which has stones like diamonds or other stones, right? And they have jewelry ranging from daily wear to wedding. In short, they have a wide range of jewelry. They design the jewelry based on in-house designs as well as on contract manufacturing. For the current generation, they also have their online selling platform wherein they have a majority stake in Innovate Lifestyles Private Limited and its online platform, Candia.com. They currently have 137 showrooms, 107 showrooms being in India and 30 showrooms outside India. In India, they have a presence in 21 states and union territories. As on 31st March 2015, they had 77 showrooms and they have increased these showrooms from 77 to 137 from 2015 to 2020. Well, let's start with an interesting history of the company. The grandfather of the current chairman and managing director, who is Mr. T.S. Kalyan Rama Iyer, he came from a family background which practiced priesthood, but he wanted to become a businessman. So that's where he chose to migrate to Thrissur, Kerala from Tanjavur, Tamil Nadu. In 1909, T.S. Kalyan Rama Iyer was a part of setting up Sitaraman Mills in Thrissur. When the state of Kerala took over this textile mill in 1950s, that's when Mr. Iyer ventured into textile retailing and opened a textile shop, which was then passed on to his son, Sitaraman Iyer. T.R. Sitaraman Iyer took his young son, Mr. T.S. Kalyanaraman, who is the current chairman and managing director of Kalyan Jewelers, by the way. So going back, T.R. Sitaraman Iyer used to take his young son, who was just 12 years of age at that time, to the textile showroom after his school. Let's fast forward a little bit. Now that 12-year-old boy, now post his graduation, took charge of the textile shop. And he was, when he took charge of the textile shop, he was also fond of a jewelry lane, I can say. There were many jewelry shops in the lane which was adjacent to his shop. And he was pretty fond of that. Many a times it used to happen that so many customers used to come to his shop to buy clothes for marriage purpose. And many customers gave him a feedback that had they also sold jewelry, the customers would have felt very convenient to buy the jewelry and clothes from the same shop. That was one of the trigger points which made him really think that, could that be done? And that's where in 1993, T.S. Kalyanaraman set up Kalyan Jewelers with just a single showroom in Kerala. But was it something different that he did? That with a single store in 1993 to 2021, the company is coming up with an IPO. What different was done? I think one of the key points was that at that time, gold shops, the people who used to sell gold, jewelry items, they did not stack up gold. They used to show the designs on a booklet. Customers used to come, could see the designs, and then they used to order the jewelry items. But what he did differently was, he actually got the ornaments made, he put them on display, and that is how customers started feeling the convenience of looking at the jewelry item and buying it right away. That was one of the major reasons for the initial success. In 2006, he converted the proprietary into a partnership firm, which got converted into a private limited company in 2009. In 2012, they expanded outside South India, where they established themselves in Ahmedabad, Gujarat. In 2013, they entered West India, Maharashtra, Maharashtra and also went overseas in Middle East Asia predominantly. In 2016, the company was converted into a public limited company, and in 2021, the company is coming up with an IPO. Let's talk about the top three strategies of Kalyan Jewelers. Number one, they don't reveal their true identity of their origin. Means what? See, whenever I use the word Kalyan Jewelers, we really don't understand where is the business originating from. So initially, I thought that it is from Kalyan. Because आपली विचारसरणी तर कल्याण डोंबिवली ठाणे याच्या पुढे तर काही जातच नाही. ओके, बट सो इवन आय केम टू नो ॲट अ व्हेरी लेटर स्टेज दॅट इट इज फ्रॉम साऊथ इंडिया. इन सिंपल वर्ड्स वॉट दे डू, नंबर टू द स्ट्रॅटेजी इज दॅट दे ॲक्च्युली डिझाईन अँड सेल हायपर लोकल प्रोडक्ट्स. मीन्स वॉट, इफ दे हॅव अ स्टोर इन महाराष्ट्र इन पुणे, देअर ज्वेलरी डिझाईन्स विल बी सच दॅट विल बी लव्ह बाय पुणेट्स. इफ दे ओपन अ स्टोर इन डेल्ली, दे विल ट्राय टू सूट द डेलीआईट्स नीड्स. इफ दे ओपन स्टोर्स इन साऊथ, इन तामिळनाडू, केरला, वॉट एव्हर, दे विल ट्राय टू एन्शुअर दॅट दे आर एबल टू अट्रॅक्ट देअर लोकल कस्टमर्स. दॅट्स वॉट वी मीन बाय हायपर लोकल प्रोडक्ट्स अँड दॅट दे आर ट्राईंग टू यूज टू देअर बिगेस्ट ॲडव्हान्टेज. नंबर थ्री एज अ बिझनेस स्ट्रॅटेजी विच आय लव्ह द मोस्ट इज द माय कल्याण स्टोर कन्सेप्ट. नाव वॉट इज दिस, आय टेल यू. What they did was that just that they wanted to enter into the rural space or to the outskirts of any city, what they did was they set up My Kalyan stores. Now, what was the thought process of setting this? There might be a possibility that people who are from the rural or from the outskirts areas, they might not prefer organized players. They might just go to an unorganized local player to buy jewelry for wedding and all that, right? But what these employees of My Kalyan do is that they tie up with astrologers, with wedding planners, and they get the data of all the customers who are wanting to get married, right? Then what the My Kalyan employees will do is that they will reach out to these customers, the potential customers, try and explain about their company, and they will try and ensure that these people come to the Kalyan Jeweler store, visit that store once, and try to potentially convert the possible customers into actual customers. So I think the whole purpose is to convert the unorganized sector crowd to the organized sector crowd. Currently, they have 766 My Kalyan locations and they have 2,699 dedicated My Kalyan employees. Their revenue, total revenue, cut 20.82% comes from the My Kalyan network as at 31st December 2020. Well, whenever we want to buy jewelry, we would go to such shops and buy jewelry. Have you ever wondered from where these guys purchase gold from? Possibility number one, whenever we sell our old gold to these players, they would melt down the old gold and they would reuse as a raw material. Possibility number one. Possibility number two, gold is sourced from banks and it is done partially through procuring it by outright purchase from the banks. Possibility number one. Or buy gold metal loans from the banks whereby bullion is loaned to them at specified interest rates. In simple words, they will buy the gold from the banks or they'll take it as a gold metal loan from the banks and pay some interest to the banks, right? Now, they have received gold. Now, what next? They'll have to make jewelry out of that. What will be the manufacturing process? So, for that, they have tied up with a network of artisans throughout India. They have entered into them with proper agreements, business agreements, which are like long-term contracts. They give them raw material. They give them designs. They will get the jewelry from them. And whatever is the risk involved, risk could be of the product, of the raw material basically, that will lie with the company. Let's understand the segment split now. 52.19% of their total revenue comes from operations from South India, 26% comes from operations outside South India, and 21.81% comes from Middle East countries. This is as at 31st March 2020. If I talk about a breakdown in respect of the materials, 74.77% comes from gold, 23.36% of the revenue comes from studded jewelry, and others is a very normal point, which is 1.87%. Now, let's talk about few risks involved in the company. I just now mentioned that 21.81% of their revenue comes from Middle East. But if you're aware about this, as per the law of the land of Middle East, if you're opening a store in Middle East, if you're opening up any business in Middle East, then 51% share has to be held by a local player. So you can imagine in this case that Kalyan Jeweler store is there in the Middle East, but 51% share is held by a local player there. Second one is the risk from an unorganized from unorganized players, which is almost 70% of the Indian jewelry market. But I told you about My Kalyan strategy, which they are trying to use to break through this unorganized players market. Number three is that they are also facing a risk of customer complaints regarding service, regarding quality of products. In fact, they also have few litigations pending in this regard. Fourth point is that they also have outstanding metal gold loans worth 8,035 millions. Now, what is this outstanding metal gold loan? Remember, I told you just few minutes ago that if Kalyan Jeweler wants to buy gold, from where will they buy it? They'll buy it from the bank, possibility number one, or possibility number two, they'll take it as a metal gold loan from the bank. Now, if RBI changes the regulations, if the regulations are changed, then it might have an adverse impact on the company. Let's move on with the industry analysis. You can see that if I go country-wise, the total global jewelry market, China again leads with 31% share in the total global jewelry, gold jewelry demand, followed by India, which is 24%. If I go by jewelry market product-wise, then 41%, it's an equal share between diamond-studded jewelry and plain gold jewelry. Now, if I talk specifically about the Indian jewelry retail industry, then it was approximately $64 billion, and the CAGR at which it grew from 2012 to 2020 was at the rate of 10.89%, and it is expected to grow at 22% between financial years 21 to 25. If you look at the chart carefully, you can see that there is a 37% sharp drop in 2021, and reason is obviously the one which you know. Is because of the COVID pandemic. Now, if you go on to this interesting chart again, it's about the jewelry demand breakup. The total demand breakup, 60%, by the way, this is 2016-17 data, 60% of the demand comes from wedding-related demand. 30% comes from the daily wear demand, and 10% comes from the fashion wear demand. My demand is, I don't have anything right now. Okay, it's okay. Next one, if I talk about the key points in India, if I'm talking about 2021, again, I came about an interesting statistic whereby the median age of our country right now, population, is 28.1 years. So now India is a market of approximately 10 million marriages annually. And this market alone is estimated to cater to 300 to 400 tons of gold. So I think this is again going to be a very interesting data point for this company. If I talk about the regional breakup now, South India caters to almost 40% of the Indian gold jewelry demand. But if I talk about North India, North India accounts for 37% of the Indian diamond or the studded jewelry demand. So it's very evident that gold is more demanded in the South and studded jewelry is more demanded in the northern regions. Why organized sector? So moving on to the next data point, why organized sector can turn out to be more preferable in the coming few years? Number one, because of the transparency and product quality. Number two, demonetization has also played a big role where people move from unorganized to organized sector. GST compliance has been one more point. Compulsory hallmarking has been another point. Mandatory PAN card on transactions above 2 lakhs has been one more point. And 100% FDI in jewelry sector under the automatic route. I think all these will be major drivers for the organized sector. Let's talk about their P&L and balance sheet. I'm going to highlight few points from the P&L. If you check out the revenue from operations, their revenues have dropped from 1,05,000 millions to 97,000 millions if I compare 18 versus 19. One of the primary reasons was because of the floods in Kerala, because of which certain showrooms they had to temporarily close down. Number two, they had also changed their strategy in My Kalyan stores, which didn't work out, and they had to revert back to their original strategy. If I compare 2019 versus 20, they have improved on their revenues part. If I compare the 9 months period ended revenues, 31st December 19 versus 20, their revenues have again dropped from 79,000 million to 55,000 million. Your reason, of course, everyone knows, is because of the pandemic. For the first entire quarter, almost their many of their showrooms were closed down. If I talk directly about PAT now, PAT has been going down from 18 to 19. Again, I told you the reason for that as well. But in 2020, they have gone past their 2018 PAT. But if I again compare the 9 months data, it has gone from a positive 943 million to negative 799 million. So from a profit of 943 million, they have gone to a loss of 799 million. When I try to dig down a little bit deep into that, what happened? I found a note number 28 in other expenses. Two major items grabbed my attention. Number one was loss on termination of leases, which accounted to 402 million rupees, and provision for impairment of assets, which was almost 344 million rupees. Now, both these are kind of one-time hit items. They are not more of recurring nature, recurring in nature. The 402 million rupees was about closure of showrooms in the Middle East. Majority of them were running into losses. That's why this decision was taken. So I hope you have understood why the losses in the for the 9 months ended 31st December 2020. Because they were in losses, obviously return on net worth is again negative for the 9 months ended December 20. If I check out their debt to equity ratio, it's fair enough at 1.12:1. Of course, with the IPO, their debt to equity ratio will further improve. Cash flow from operations, again, if I compare 18 to 19, it was worse. Again, I've told you the reasons for that as well. 19 to 20, fair enough. But again, for 31st December 2020, 9 months ended, they have a negative cash flow from operations. Let's do a peer comparison. As per the prospectus, their only peer is Titan Company Limited. And if I compare the total income, Titan versus Kalyan Jewelers, Kalyan Jewelers' income is like half of that of Titan. If I talk about the EPS, Titan's EPS is 16.91, their EPS is 1.70. If I talk about return on net worth, Titan's return on net worth is 22.38, and Kalyan's net worth return on net worth is just 6.63%. Even if I talk about the NAV per share, Titan is 75.12 and Kalyan is just 25.71. So it looks like a very small company as compared to its peer, but this is my personal opinion. This is not about RHP. But I personally feel is Titan is not also their truest peer because Titan is into so many other products. So I didn't like this as the only peer of the company. That's my personal opinion. Let's quickly understand the IPO details. Issue opens on 16th March, closes on 18th of March. Its IPO price is 86 rupees to 87 rupees. It's going to get listed on BSE and NSE both. It's a mix of fresh issue as well as OFS. Fresh issue is of 800 crores and OFS is just 375 crores. There's going to be an employee discount as well. If I talk about the pre-issue holding and post-issue holding, it's going down from 67.99% to 60.53%. The cutoff amount for the maximum lots comes to 1,94,532. For the objects of the issue, they're going to use this for the working capital requirement and to meet general corporate purposes. Who are the promoters who are selling their shareholders? Mr. T.S. Kalyan Raman, who is going to sell 1,250 million by selling the shares. And one more selling shareholder is Heidel Investment, but it is just an investment vehicle. The actual investor is the large private equity firm, which is Warburg Pincus. You might have heard about this. They are going to sell 2,500 million worth shares in the company. Well, I hope you enjoyed a detailed analysis of this company, of the industry as a whole, their strategies and a lot more things. But am I going to invest in this IPO or not? For that, you will have to check out my live stream on the 18th at 11 a.m. live on YouTube. Till then, take care. Jai Hind and bye-bye.